The video you're about to watch is a game from the 2019 FIDE World Rapid and Blitz Chess Championship between Maxim Matlakov of Russia playing the white pieces and world champion Magnus Carlsen of Norway playing the black pieces. As we can see here, Matlakov played the move 1d4, but Magnus is taking his time as King Solomon himself comes and graces us with his presence. He looks upon skeptically before seeing the opening get started between these two young gentlemen. We have a move order with knight f3 to avoid the Nimzo and then d5 by the world champion. Knight c3 sees c6, a transposition into main line variations, but with bishop g5, knight bd7, and e3, the real surprise comes here when the world champion plays queen a5, the Cambridge Springs defense. Matlakov knows what he's doing in this line, as Magnus is about to find out, plays knight d2, and after bishop b4, rook c1, the move knight e4 comes in as a very common trap in this line. You're not only hitting the bishop on g5, but also the knight on c3. If white chooses to take on e4, the biggest problem with these variations is that the capture's back not only renews a threat of the bishop, but a2 is still hanging and the pin can be a problem. But Matlakov, as I said, knows these variations, as we learned, captures with the correct knight before retreating the bishop safely away from the queen. Now, this variation is a well-known pawn sacrifice. Queen takes a2 is met by queen to c2. And though Matlakov paused there before capturing on e4 with the d knight, as we saw, you're going to find out that he actually knows these variations quite well. One of the key games in this line, after the move 11 knight to b6, which is not what Magnus plays here in a second, goes bishop e2, and with the move knight a4, overdoing the pin with all of these pieces and the threat here, white actually has the surprising castles where we head to an endgame, and despite the fact that white is down a pawn, white is almost winning on the spot with rook a1, and then f3 to open up variations, followed by the idea of defending the c3 pawn so that the rooks can double on the a-file, and ultimately be much, much better in an endgame with active rooks and the bishop pair. You can look up this game in my blog where I analyzed this variation deeply. Matlakov and Svetushkin is the game from Portokeras in Greece 2018. But as we said, Magnus takes a moment and instead of playing the move knight to b6, retreats the queen to a5. This move is a novelty that was quickly met by queen takes e4 from Matlakov, now no longer afraid of hiding the fact that he knows what he's doing. And we see Magnus's expression there like, well, I guess I'm worse here. And you've kind of proven yourself that you know this variation. So I'm going to pause for a moment before trying to head to an endgame. This is Magnus doing what Magnus does best, recognizing that even if he didn't necessarily make the best opening choice, he knows that he can still stay on the board and outplay anybody, so he invites an endgame where black is definitely worse, but sees if Matlakov is up to the task of outplaying him with a bishop pair and a very good center. Magnus now plays very quickly with the move knight to b6, which not only defends f5, but hits c4. White is objectively better, so we can't kid ourselves about the fact that Magnus was definitely worse out of the opening and may have gambled wrong when he played the Cambridge Springs. But after the move castles, and now we see Magnus taking a moment before he's about to play the move bishop to e6 on the board, so I'll do it, threatening the c4 pawn. The real question will be whether Matlakov can come up with the most accurate approach from here and show that not only does he know the opening well, maybe even better than Magnus, but he's prepared to convert on the endgame. He ultimately decides to go for the most direct variation of d5, which the engines approve of. I admit if I was playing this position myself, I might try to sit on my very, very comfy bishop pair and space advantage with a move like knight e2 to defend c4 and head to f4, which is what the engines suggest as perhaps the second best option. But again, Matlakov is not afraid, and despite the way he paused before playing the move queen c2 we saw in the video, Isekara Nakamura does nothing but pause in the background, playing his game very, very quickly versus Yu Yongyi. He ultimately goes for the direct line here with d5. Now, the idea here is very simple. He hopes that the trade will ultimately not only expose a king in the center, but create a great tactics for white. Because of that, Magnus is not interested, takes on c3 and tries to mix things up. The problem is that after d takes e6, bishop takes b2, and then the move rook to b1, Matlakov is still in control of the game with the bishop pair as the position opens up. Now, he does make his first real inaccuracy here with rook to b1. The better move, as we saw Magnus just play bishop a3 on rook b1, would have been rook c2. Here, he could have met bishop a3 with c5, actually keeping the bishop trapped, something you can only do with the rook on c2. And if the knight moves, variations like this would be more than clearly better for white, with the bishop awkwardly positioned, threats like rook a1 and a king that still has not gotten itself out of the center. But I digress back to the real game because Matlakov played rook b1. As I said, maybe his first slight inaccuracy. Bishop to a3 was chosen. Bishop takes f5, and after g6, we see the bishop retreat to h3. Despite my criticism of the fact that rook c2 was better than rook b1, the truth is white is still in control here. You have the bishop pair. You still have pressure of the open file. And the fact that black's king is in the center is not ideal. D takes e6, bishop takes e6 is going to keep it there from now until kingdom come, as there's no longer a right to castle to either side. But after bishop to e7, Matlakov plays bishop g3. Still making the best decisions, like he knows these endgames. Obviously, you don't want to trade and let black get the king in the center and connect the rooks with a natural developing move. So instead, he played bishop g3, and after the move, knight a4, plays bishop e5, and we see the move rook to f8. This moment right here, as you saw Matlakov pause before playing bishop g7, is the one that we're going to come back to after the video. So do make sure you stick around and find out the surprisingly brilliant and subtle move the engines say white should have played here instead of going for what he did. Matlakov plays bishop g7 and goes for the exchange. We make a few moves to catch up to the fact that after bishop g4, a5, and f4, we suddenly realize that actually Magnus's exchange sack was rather brilliant. The a-pawn is coming very quick, the bishop is coming to this dark square diagonal, and it may indeed already be true that black is in control. In fact, after the next move, f5, that we just saw on the board from Matlakov, if you give the computers long enough to think, I did because I stepped away for lunch, the computers actually already believe black is better here. Knight to e4 is played after the move a3, rook a1, and after f takes, g6 takes. As we said, this is already a big trouble for Matlakov because the threats of advancing the a-pawn and using the bishop are very strong. He played bishop e6, but after bishop g7 and knight to c3, he's starting to feel the pressure. We now see rook a2 and knight c3 coming on the board right now. If the rook moves, the a-pawn runs. If you don't move the rook, I'm taking it, and you're still in big trouble. And we can see that somehow, some way, Matlakov, feeling how a lot of people often feel when they play Magnus, bewildered by how he wasn't just better in the middle game after winning the exchange. But Magnus takes a second, leans back, fiddles the piece because he realizes, wait, I don't have to do anything. All of white's pieces are completely stuck, so it's time to activate the king. King to e7. Precise all the way to the end is Magnus Carlsen's style. Bishop moves, and only now do I play knight e2 check to pick up the rook. I'm going to come back here in just a second and show you exactly why, as they shake hands, why king e7 was important. In this position here, if you go for knight e2 check first, instead of king to e7, and then take, white has to move c5, and then the pawn will fall before the bishop can get out of the way and bring a new baby girl to the a1 square. So not only was king e7 super accurate, but again, just patient, and you could see Magnus as he paused on the video before taking a second to find this very accurate move. Again, it's just the brilliant chess that Magnus Carlsen comes up with on a regular basis that impresses us all. So king e7 was needed to kick the bishop from this diagonal, again, so that only then you play knight e2 check, win the rook, and as we said, there is no longer the move c5 with the bishop and rook holding perhaps a drawn obstacle bishop ending. But I deliver on my promises, despite what my wife and kids might tell you. And I'm going to go back to the key position where Matlakov actually had a brilliant and subtle idea that would have probably won the game had he seen it. Now, it's very understandable to be in a position where you've been dominating the opening, you're clearly better with the bishop pair, and the move knight a4, while it surprised you, is not really unleashing that hard of a tactic to see. The main point is that if you take b7, black has knight to c5, forking the rook and bishop. This problem is the key for black's position. The fact that white would much rather take this pawn than win the exchange is not lost on anybody. If you don't have knight to c5, winning this pawn is not only more destructive for black, it threatens things like bishop d7, and the game is probably over very, very soon. But again, the fact that Magnus played this very creative move, knight a4, put the pressure on Matlakov to come up with the right idea. When he realized he couldn't take, because of this fork on c5, he settled on what seems to be a very clear win of material, bishop g7. But as we saw in the game, not only was this sack proven out, But actually, after several more moves, and again, you let the computers think, you would argue that after a5 is played, black might not even be worse already. But that's just the key. a5 was allowed with the move order that Matlakov played. So on that note, what was the brilliant idea white could have played here that surprises us all and leaves white in a probably much easier to win position? The move is bishop to d4, xclam. The main point is that by guarding c5, you create and renew the threat of rook takes b7. And there's no way to guard the b-pawn other than to play b6 yourself. Just to show you, rook b8 would lose a7 to the bishop, and knight to c5 would allow the trade, and then rook takes b7. And again, that pawn and the obstacle bishop attack, much more valuable to white than winning the exchange. So, if Carlsen indeed had to settle on b6, we now go for the exact same line as we had in the game. But the main difference being after captures, and bishop g4, black is unable to play the move a5 without the move rook takes b6 being on the board. This position would have been much, much easier for white to play. Black has to solve multiple problems. How do I advance my a-pawn without losing b6? And how do I deal with the plan that Matlakov came up with in the game, f4, f5? It makes sense to try to create new lines for the rook, for the rooks to play with when you won the exchange. The only problem, as we saw, was that the a-pawn was too strong. So once again, kind of a brilliant and subtle, hard to hold against Matlakov move for him to not find bishop d4. But indeed, that was the critical moment, and a move that if he had found in the game just to induce b6 may have changed his fate in the exact type of line, as running the a-pawn is no longer a fast option for the world champion. But again, it was a great game, an exciting exchange sacrifice, and interesting to see that Magnus was able to rebound from perhaps a risky and dubious opening choice, but Matlakov unable to do what a lot of people aren't able to do, which is convert better middle games into the end games against the legend from Norway. Hope you're enjoying these live analysis sessions from the videos that the chess.com team was able to capture at the FIDE World Rapid and Blitz in Moscow, and there are more coming your way.